our great day in this weekend before. Before Labor Day. And we know that a lot of people are traveling. A lot of people are in vacation with their families. Even in this COVID. God bless you for those of you. In the name of Jesus, the Lord shall make you to be the head and not the tail. You shall not be beneath. You shall be above always. But I just want to give you this. I want you to know that God loves you and we love you also. In this economy, if God allows you to still have breath in this season, there is something that is not yet completed about you. The Bible says there is a hope for a tree that when it's cut off, it shall rise up again. Many of you are coming out being better than how you got into this. Makota sakataba, rekata shikotobo, lebaga sakataba, likanama shikotobo. In the name of Jesus Christ. The word for us today is walking of purpose. The walking I'm talking about is taking a walk, not like the ability to push something or put. I'm talking about W-A-L-K, walking of purpose. Once you discover, now you now know what to do. You begin to take the walk. And the Bible says the entrance of the word bringeth light and understanding to the simple. Lord, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Then the word that we are speaking now and hearing, not be at the tattooing word of a man, but let it be the word of God that will bring glory to thy holy name. In the name of Jesus Christ. So we are going to go into the word. Hallelujah. I want you to share this on your wall. If you are on my Facebook page and you are connected to us in any form or way, let God lead you this hour. Share this to someone that you know. Share it in your family circle. Share it everywhere. Walking of purpose. Hallelujah. Let's go to the beginning of beginnings. Genesis chapter 1. Hallelujah. We are going to start from verse 26 and see the intent and intentions of God and what it generated and what it ought to be. And we can be able to get ourselves acquainted to why we were called. Everyone that is born on earth has a purpose. God does not just make people do for making sake, and your purpose has been already predestined before you were born. It's not when you come, then God will start to say, okay, what shall he become? What will he become? And let me tell you something. God gives us our destinies and purpose based on our tribe. You start with your tribe, with your family. I told you that the work of God is family oriented. God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion. So man was created for God to have an extension of himself on earth. So God was interested in family before he created man. So destinies are fulfilled by family. Purpose are run by family. It has to be family. And whatever you think you are doing today has been given to your family. Maybe somebody did not finish it. Somebody started it before. And you might came and give your part. Because everybody have been doing their part unto the perfect day. And if a generation comes and they don't fulfill the purpose of that tribe or that family, that does not mean that that thing will die. It's still there until somebody that will be born in that family begins to run on it again. Amen. Makatasokotobo. So let's go to Genesis chapter 1:26. And the Bible said, then God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness and let them have dominion. So I told you, the goal of God to create man is for man to be a dominant force. We're going to talk about that in a minute. So God said, let them have dominion. Amen. And what are they going to dominate? Over the fishes of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. The Bible says, verse 27, so God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created him, male and female, he created them. Then God began to say something in 28, and the Bible said, and God blessed them. By this time, man has not been formed yet. Man was created. This man was in the spirit. And the Bible said, God blessed them. And God said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Hallelujah. And have dominion over the fishes of the seas, over the birds, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So the five creative blessings that God gave to man: be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, and have dominion. Every man has that. Regardless of who you are, you were created not as an intention, but it was deliberate that you have to be fruitful. You were created not as an intention, but it's deliberate that you have to multiply. So God has created us to have all these things. So I don't want you to look at yourself and say whether somebody has more than you. We are running a race that is personal to us and God. Your assignment and my assignment is not to be the same. So many times we look at other people and we want to be like them, but we don't have the same calling. Our purpose and their purpose is not the same. In the name of Jesus Christ. So let's analyze what God told man in Genesis chapter 1:28. The Bible says, and God blessed them. And God blessed them. God said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, and have dominion. But all these things happen in the spirit. Because by this time, Adam has not been created yet, but has not been formed. Man has been created, but man has not been formed. The creation of Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 are totally different. Everything that existed, they were in existence somewhere before they appeared. The children that will be born in the next 100 years have been created. God is never creating anything anymore. When their time comes, based on their tribe and their race and their call, God will send them to the family, because God is a family man. Amen. Amen. So God is after family. That's why I tell you, the blessings are always in the family. It's not only man. I see people say, oh, God bless me, me. Yeah, you can say you, but if it does not align with the family blessings, it's not coming to you. It has to align with the intention of God that is deliberate concerning your family. Then when you discover a secret about your family, and now you talk about your tribe, because it goes from family to tribe. That's why in the 12 tribes of Israel, they all represent different things. The people that are from the tribe of Levite cannot desire to be royalty. Even if they desire, they will never be king, because God has said, kings shall be Judah. I want us to understand these things. That Judah is a blood that has royalty in it. He said, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. So, but if you look at from the time of Judah in the book of Genesis, Judah never became king. He lost it because he went and be with the wife of his sons and brought these children, Zara and them. He brought these two boys, and there was confusion of who is the first. It took 10 generations to correct that. And David was the 10th generation. And David became the first king that came from Judah. But king has always... So David will not say, oh,
I'm special because I mean, no, Judah was pronounced to be king. His third generation ancestor, Jacob, said, Judah, thou shalt rule over your brothers. The scepter shall not depart from you. So it is already in your tribe. Until somebody that will align their will with the will of God, that thing will not happen. Many times you are born in a family, maybe nobody has become a priest in your lifetime, and you are a priest. Go back and look, there are priests in your family. There might be priests of idol worshiping, there might be priests of voodoo, but priesthood has always been in your family. It doesn't just happen mistakenly. God always chose people based on what is in their tribe and in their bloodline. So God said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, and have dominion. But what happened? When God created Genesis chapter 2 now, brought the formation of the man, and man was formed out of dust, which is under time. You know, everything that is under the earth is controlled by time. So what did God do? When God formed man from dust, God now took the man that was in the spirit. The Bible says he breathed into this man that is controlled by time, with the one that was in him, because God is eternity. God is eternity, past, present, and future. He has no end, he has no beginning. And we all have no end, and we have no beginning. We came from God, but that is it. We cannot end. But what happened? But because we existed in the formation of something that has an end. I don't want to lose you, but I want you to understand this thing. Once we get it, we will now pursue our destiny easily. I'm talking about walking of peoples. The walking of peoples, how you take a walk. When you know your peoples, when you discover your peoples, it is easy to recover it. Because now you know. You are not going to be looking at what somebody else is doing, because you know who you are. You know what you want to be. So the Bible says God breathed into the nostril of the man that he has formed. And man became a living soul. So now in Adam is two personalities. A man that is limited to time and a man that has no limit. So in Adam was eternity already. And God gave a charge. The Bible says in the midst of the garden in Genesis 2, there was a tree of life and evil. And God said, don't eat it. When you eat it, you die. So Adam, we knew the story of a serpent that came. And that means Adam was not doing his job. For a serpent to be rolling around the garden. A garden is the neatest part of the house. When you have a house and you have a garden, you always tend the garden. You clean it up. You don't see snakes in garden. Any garden that has snakes running around it, you are not doing your job. So Adam was not really doing a good job for snakes to invade the garden. Why would it be a dog? A dog is domesticated. A cat. But a snake should be out there in the bush, not in the garden. The Bible says the snake tripped the woman. The woman fell because the devil has to enter into the body of the snake. But there was a curse. The garden was not well taken care of. And Adam fell. When Adam fell, Adam did not physically die. But what happened? He lost eternity. He lost his fellowship with God. Remember, God was his source. So when he lost his source, he began to be in what? And because of what Adam has done, God said, now the whole earth is polluted. Now you have to till the earth to get food. Normally food grow. You don't have to do much. When the Bible says God never called trees out in the creations. He never called trees. Say, mango, come. No. What God did, he said the earth should produce. Oh, so God yielded some part of his authority to the earth. That the earth should produce everything that is good for food. In their numbers. That the earth should produce it. And the earth brought all kinds of vegetation. So that God does not have to, because if God said, let there be mango, let there be this, that means God has to do it. every time mango dies, he has to create another mango. So God yielded that to the earth. So what the earth does, I want you to know that if we leave this place today, and nobody shows up here for 1 year, trees will grow inside this place. Trees will begin to grow. Because the earth was commanded to bring forth. So God yielded part of his nature unto the earth. It doesn't matter how great or beautiful a place is. When you leave it for a while, you start to see weeds growing. You start to see trees growing. You start to see things grow out of cement. You wonder why? Because the earth has the ability to produce things. What we do is to tend those things so that they don't get out of hand. We are talking about walking of purpose. So when Adam fell, his wife fell, they lost the ability to be in charge of everything. Remember when God created man, God told them that they should subdue everything. You know what is subdue? You subdue, you don't negotiate to subdue. You know, in this case, they say there's democracy. We have to have opinion in everything. When you are subduing, nobody has an opinion. You are in charge. You take control. You are the one that is called. You do it with authority. And that was the right that God gave to man. Every animal was at the feet of man, including the lions and the tigers, because man was a dominant force. When Adam failed, that was when the animal began to eat each other. No. The animals that eat flesh have been eating flesh. But in the time of Adam, Adam was so strong as an authority that because of Adam, they cannot eat of flesh. So when Adam lost what he had, that is when man is being attacked now by wild cats. Those animals supposed to fear us. We they're supposed to be afraid of man. Because man had the image of God, and man came from eternity. They came from earth. Man does not expire, they expire. Hallelujah. So we lost it, and the earth began to go into drought and all these things. But let's go forward. I'm telling you that blessings are in family. Let's go to Genesis chapter 12. And God began to look for a way to redeem man. Hallelujah. Marco to Sakataba. How great thou art. How great thou art. Look at Genesis chapter 11. I want us to read from verse 27. This is talking about Abraham now, where he started. With nobody. I told you that whatever you are becoming or whatever you become has always been in your tribe, in your family. The blessings of Abraham, his father could have gotten it, but his father missed it. Genesis chapter 11, verse 27. This is the genealogy of Terah. Terah begat Abraham, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran begat Lot. And Haran died before his father. And Terah, in his native land of Ur, of the Chaldees. Verse 29, Genesis chapter 11, I'm ready. Look at 29. And Abraham and Nahor took wives. And Abraham's wife was Sarah. And the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, and the father of Iscah. Verse 30. And Sarah was barren. She had no child. 31. And Terah took his son Abraham and his grandson Lot and the son of Haran and his daughter-in-law Sarah and his son Abraham's wife, and they went out with them from all of the Chaldees to go to the land of Canaan. You see, when God called Abraham and put him in Canaan, his father was already going to Canaan, but he never saw Canaan. He died.
Wow.
So many times I tell you, what you become today has always been in your family. Tara, his intention was to leave Ur and end up in Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they stayed.
And the man died there. So when God called Abraham, God said, continue the journey of your father. You see, when I read the book of the former president, 44th president Barack Obama, talking about dreams of his father came to America, studied in economics, graduated, worked a while, went back to Africa, wanted to be president of Kenya. You know, he was not in the life of his son for all these years. Obama didn't know. When he died, later in the 80s, I think 81 or 82, Obama went down to Kenya, discovered about his father, read much about him, discovered that his father wanted to be president of Kenya, would not make it. He now later became what? President of America. Presidency has been in their bloodline. His father desired, he got a job in America that would have paid him when he refused and went back to Kenya. His quest was to go and bring this great knowledge to the people of Kenya. They frustrated him with that. That's why Obama wrote that book and said, Dreams of My Father. His father's dream was to be president. So he was not the first person that wanted to be president. It always goes back into the family. It's a bloodline thing. God bless people in tribe. And many times when you don't meet up to the alignment of who you are, you have not discovered what blessing was in your family. That's why to discover your purpose is very important. What we are talking about today is the working of the purpose. Once you discover, it is easy to achieve it because it has been there. It has always been there. There is nothing new. You can come out and be the best. And you look back three generations, there's nobody that has been like you. If you go back 1,000 years, you will find somebody that was even much better than you in that bloodline. If I had this, I spoke in tongue. There's something they say in my language, where something is, never ends. Like if somebody was wealthy and they died. Poverty might reign for the 3, 4, 5 generations. But wealth was already in that family. Wealth will always come back to that family. Because it has been in the bloodline. So Abraham, Genesis chapter 12 now. By this time he didn't know God. His father wanted to go to Haran. His father died in Haran. He didn't go to Canaan. Genesis 12. Now the Lord said to Abraham, get out of the country from thy family and from thy father's house to the land which I will show you. I will make you great, a great nation. I will bless you and make thy name great. And thou shalt become a blessing. And I will bless those that bless you, and I will curse him that curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. And Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. If you look down now, as they began to journey down, let's go to verse 7. Let's stay in numbers 5. He said, Abraham took Sarah his wife and Lot his brother's son and all their possessions that they had gathered and the people whom they had acquired in Haran and departed and go to the land of what? Canaan. That was his father's dream, to go to Canaan. You remember when there was famine in Canaan, he went to Egypt and God blessed him and brought him back to what? Canaan. Canaan was their destination originally. I met a woman in South Africa. The daughter was an air hostess. And the daughter was working and making some great money. So she started to despise the mother. She don't come home. She don't. You know, the mother was very faithful. And one day the mother came for counseling and we started talking. And the mother said, all my life I have watched people that work in the airplane. I wanted to be an air hostess. I even went to the school. But I could not make it because in those days was recent, she was a black woman. So they did not choose her, even though she was mixed. She said, I qualified her past everything. So when my daughter was born, now the laws have shifted, things have changed. The daughter was going to do medicine. Later she changed, said she wanted to be a doctor. The mother was so happy. Now she became that and she began to despise the mother. She don't come home, you know, she has a house in the city. She lives very well. And what I was saying, this was what I dreamt to be. I never become it. When my daughter came back and told me that she wanted to go to the school of aviation, I was so happy. I had to sell everything I had to make sure she got it. And she got it. Now she's despising me. So one day I met the daughter, I was talking to her. I said, do you know that your position is what your mother started? That you are competing? She said, she never told me that. I said, go and ask your mother. She has wanted to be on an airplane as a young child. She didn't make it. Maybe she was not even the first person. If you go down the line, maybe there was somebody else in their bloodline that always wanted, dreamt about it. You know, these things that we see happen, God blesses people based on their tribe. That's why when the 12 tribes came, God told them what they will become through Jacob. And you cannot move from one tribe and say, I will become this. Your tribe has the kind of blessings that come to them. The tribes of Levi were known for priesthood. And somebody that is from Judah can never desire to be a priest. Because it is not in their bloodline. So if you pray from today till tomorrow, God will not answer that prayer. So but these times were when man was living under time. But Jesus came back and gave us something. I want us to see. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 11. I want to run and just know if I can do justice to this message. Walking of purpose. Hebrews chapter 11, I want us to read verse 3, maybe 3 to 5. Oh, labagashika na masekataba. Rakutu sakataba. Likoro kushikiriba. Mazika karaba. Hebrews 11. Hallelujah. I read verse 3. The Bible says, by faith, we understand that the world are framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen are not made of the things which do what? Appear. Some things say the things which do, we call visible. It did not say the things that exist. For the things that we see, the chairs and all these things, they are not made from the things that do appear. The chairs that you see has been in the spirit. Before you gave birth to it, before the first man that made chair thought about chair, chair has existed in the spirit. When you talk about God sitting in the, how can God sit? Is he sitting on the air? The Bible says in the book of Psalm 89, verse 14, that the Bible says the throne of God is righteousness and justice, and God is sitting on top of it. So things that do appear are not made from the things that we that are visible. They are made from things that are already in the spirit. Before we now see them come to pass. That's why Solomon said, there is nothing new under the earth. Hallelujah. John chapter 17. Look at Jesus now. Telling you about what Jesus did for us in salvation. So the man that fell in the garden became limited because of time. But since we got Jesus Christ, we are unlimited. John chapter 17. Look at verse 4 and 5. Are we there? Jesus said to God, this time Jesus has not died yet. He has not gone to the cross. But what did he say here? I have glorified you on earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. Verse 5. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before what? Before the world began. He was already, if you read in the book of Genesis, Jesus has been born, he has died, and he has resurrected before he was born and died and resurrected. God has seen redemption before it played out. So what do we get in salvation? The day we become children of God, the Bible says, as many that received in John chapter 1 verse 12, then he gave the power, which is a spirit, to become the sons of God, which is the highest level of relationship with God. The son of God is like his father. So God is always talking to us in the family way. He doesn't talk to us as God, because he doesn't want to be a God to us. He wants to be our father.
But if we want to talk about king, he is our God because he's a king. But in terms of our relationship with him, he is our father. He gave birth to us. So the nature of God is eternity. And every man has eternity in them. I want you to see something here. Rabakashikatama. Masoko Toroboli Kakasha. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I want to know if I can do justice to this. I want to know if you can get me now. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Oh, Bakarabasiko Tobusakatama. Holy Lord. Jesus is the last glory.
Verse 1, the Bible says,
to everything there is what? Time and season. A time for every purpose under heaven. So if you look at that now, that is God has set things the way it's going to be. There is time for that. That's why sometimes things delay in the family. Let's say the family has been ordained to be Babylonians. But in the will that God wrote about your family, God said, until you finish school, high school, went to college, graduate, get married, then you are blessed. Then, first generation, nobody graduated, nobody got married. That generation will go back. Second generation, nobody graduated, nobody got married. They couldn't meet the criteria. Maybe in the fourth generation, somebody graduated, got married. And they became so blessed from a family that has been so poor. And you say, what happened? Wealth has always been in that family, but there are criteria which are demands. I remember the children of God, God said 400 years before they went into captivity. In Genesis, God was talking to Abraham. Abraham has no child. Genesis 17, God told him, your children shall sin against me, and they will go into captivity, and they will spend 400 years there. I will bring them back here, and they're not going to come out empty. Abraham has no child. God has seen Isaac. God has seen Jacob. God has seen the 12 sons of Jacob. God has seen Israel. Has seen them in Egypt. Before Abraham had one child, God has told him about his children going into captivity. And they are going to come back. God said 400 years. What happened? They spent 470 years in captivity. The 70 years, what happened? 400 years, they have expired in Egypt. God gave birth to who? Moses. Before 400 years. So Moses now, at the age of 10, Moses is supposed to now understand who he was. But he was busy learning the magician of the Egyptians, learning the science of Egypt. Went to school, so he wasted 40 years. And when God left, asked him to leave, because if a prince kills somebody, nobody questioned him. We have preached it wrong that he killed an Egyptian. They wanted to kill him. Nobody wanted to kill him. He was a prince. He can look at an Egyptian and say, I don't like your face. Cut his head off and they kill you. That's it. You don't challenge royal blood. But Moses now, God sent him to the wilderness, because the Bible says the step of the righteous is ordered by the Lord. And when he went there, Moses refused to grow up. Even though he was serving the priest of the Midianites, he spent another 40 years there. God decided to arrest him by force, call him out of the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3. God said, Moses, pull off your shoes, for where you are is the holy ground. Now you go back to Egypt, tell Pharaoh to let my people go, that they might serve me. And he said, I have heard the cry of my people, and I have come down to deliver them. Because the Egyptians, the Jews knew that they're supposed to be there for 400 years. So they began to pray, say, God, you say 400, why are we still here? What are we still doing here? But the deliverer is not up to that age. He has not matured to handle. Moses was a hot-tempered man. If you allow him, he would have killed the whole Israelite. But God has to deal with his temper. Yeah. God has to deal with his anger. God has to remove all those anger in him. And why we say Moses came back and became the meekest man in Israel.
Glory. Woo.
When he now was 45, he cannot lead these people out with anger. It won't work. And if Moses refused to have grown, probably they will still be there. Maybe somebody else will come. God is not like him too. But the demand must be met. You must meet the demand for the presence of God. And the Bible says the gift of God is not unto repentance. That's why sometimes you see unbelievers get blessed. And you say, God, I've been serving you. It's not about your service. There are things that are supposed to be done. If you have not done it yet, it will not align with the will of God. I want you to see this Ecclesiastes we just read. Look at verse 11. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Look at verse 11. Does anybody have NIV? I would like you to read it in NIV. I want you to see. The Bible says he has made everything beautiful in his time. And also he has set, he has put what? Eternity. Did you see it in your Bible? Eternity in the heart, in their heart. Except that no one can find out the work that God does from the beginning to the end. Every man has what? Eternity in them. So we are not beings of here. We are not under time. Our body is under time because our body was created when time has been in existence. You know, remember when God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God separated the light from the darkness, and the light he called day, and darkness is called night. That was when time was created. So the man that was formed in Genesis chapter 2 was under the sun and the moon. That man has to expire. But the man that God breathed into that man cannot expire. So Adam was an eternity man that lived in things that have time. So you cannot die. You cannot. That's why the Bible said God is interested in your soul. That is why the devil is also interested in your soul. Because the soul of a man cannot be caged. The soul of a man cannot die. If people remove their body, their soul continues to live. Because you are created with the spirit of eternity. So God has put eternity in the heart of a man.
Hallelujah.
So if we know that we are eternal beings, and the things that we see are not made from the things that exist, that do appear, because those things exist somewhere, we begin to speak like God. I want you to see something. Maybe I'm going to tie it up here. Oh, Karabasakataba. Mansikotoroburukatashakataba. Philippians chapter 2. Oh, Rakatashakataba. Philippians chapter 2. It's a let this mind. If you look at verse 5, we don't have to read all of them. Let this mind. Did you see it in your Bible? What did he say? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So if we have the mind of Christ, we have, then we can live forever. Then we are above what? You know, sometimes Christians waste their time fighting the devil. We're supposed to subdue the enemy. We don't fight him. We are not in the same class with him. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 3, for Christ is the end of principalities and powers. That is where we are staying. We are in the divine authority. I don't have time to waste time with the devil. I can once in a while ask them to leave, get out, bind them, or cast them out, or rebuke them. But I won't dwell my life, all my life, following the devil, following the activity of the enemy, because that limits who you are. God has put some kind of ability in you. That is the ability of Christ. The Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. The mind of Christ. Knowing fully well that you have overcome the earth. You are not who the devil thinks you are. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9. O Karabashi Kataba. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9. We thank you, Lord, we worship you for revelation. Look at verse 9 and 10. Oh, rabba, rabba, rabba. Thank you, Jesus. The working of purpose. Having made known to us the mysteries of his will according to his good pleasure, which he proposed in himself. Verse 10. In the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, in him. So he has made us this mystery that nobody figured out. But we are both spiritual.
spiritual and physical beings. He will now make it known to us. And many of us that have discovered that secret, we live above the economy of America, because our source is not United States of America. God is our source. America is our resource place. So the place of resource, we have to produce. They are not your source. Every time you take your eyes off something and put it on God, then you work. I told you, when God met Moses, and in Genesis chapter, Exodus chapter 4, I think verse 7 or so, Moses had a stick. And God said, what is you? God knew what it was in his hand. God has seen that stick in his hand for years. He said, what is in your hand? He said, a staff. I know Moses will say, God, what is it? This is a staff. You know it. He said, drop it on the floor. Give it to me. He left it. It became a snake. When he left that staff became a living thing. When he picked it back, he died. Every time you give God what is in your hand, it comes alive. He dropped it, it became a living thing. It became a snake. And once it's right, God said, don't run. Go back and pick it from the tail. When he picked it, it became a staff. God said, now, this staff is alive. Depending on how you want to use it. If you want it to come alive, it comes alive. But it can still be a staff. And do you know that everything Moses did was with that staff? The power of God manifested in that staff. But he had that staff for 40 years. The staff was just taking care of the goats and the sheep. Until he met God, the staff in his hand became the power of God. I don't know what you are not looking for something else. What you will use to make it is already inside of you. Until you discover, you cannot recover. When you discover, you start to walk in your purpose. You start to quit looking at what some people have. They were not there when God created you. They didn't know what God told you. So you go and do what God asks you to do. Don't care about what other people are doing. You are not in the same assignment. In fact, sometimes you are not from the same tribe with them. Your tribe in the spirit is different. And every time you want to get the blessings of another tribe, it will not work. It will not work. Because there is something that is in your tribe that God has given you. And if you take it from tribe, you take it down to family. And remember that the prophets have prophesied about Bethlehem. He said, oh Bethlehem, one of the least of the princes, out of you shall come a king that will rule Israel. What happened? Jesus was born in Bethlehem. It has been there more than 1,000 years. That prophecy keep coming upon Bethlehem. But even when Jesus was born, the Jews did not remember. They didn't know. It was the wise men, the astrologers, the witches and wizards told the king in the book of Matthew. And the king said, asked the people, where will the king be born? And they told him in Bethlehem. Because the prophet said, out of Bethlehem shall come a king. These things have always been. Find out who you are. And life will be easy. Hallelujah. And the blessing that we thought that Adam lost, we have gotten it back. The Bible says, Christ has what? Redeemed us from the curse of the land. The land was cursed the day Adam sinned. That land is not cursed anymore. He said, cursed is every man that hangeth upon the tree. So if I'm redeemed, the garden of, I'm going to show you that garden. What happened? We don't have time to read Bible now. Our time is up. I'm going to be up in 2 minutes. But let me tell you something. When Jesus went to baptism, in Luke chapter 3 and Matthew chapter 4, chapter 3, he came out of baptism. The Bible says the Spirit led him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And remember, when Adam left the garden has become a wilderness. Because Adam did not tend the garden, and snakes was growing in it. So when Jesus was led, Jesus came back in the nature of Adam. He has to go back and continue where Adam stopped. He went back to the wilderness. And what came up there after he has prayed? A snake came again. And Jesus overcame that snake. So what Adam lost in the garden, Jesus brought back in the wilderness after 40 years. That the Bible says when he came out, he was filled with Holy Ghost and power. And his fame went abroad in Matthew chapter 4. But I want you to see how the garden has been restored. Our caravan. Oh, I hope you just get this thing today. Look at Revelation. Go to the book of Revelation. Your mind will be blown out. Revelation chapter 22. And we call it a day today. Our caravan. Revelation 22. I want us to read verse 1 to 5. Carefully. This is the restored garden. The garden is not a wilderness anymore. It's now a garden. And it is also to us a garden. Revelation chapter 22, look at verse 1. And he showed me a pure river. What happened? In the Garden of Eden, what happened? There were rivers. So God took us back to the Garden of Eden.
Amen.
A pure river of life, clean as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and the Lamb. In the middle of the street and on the other side of the river was the tree of what? Life. What was in the Garden of Eden? The tree of life and the tree of knowledge. God now removed that one that Adam sinned against. The tree of life was there. Hakarabababababa. Are you getting it? And in, it was a tree of life which bore 12 fruits. Each tree yielded its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for healings of the nations. And there shall be no more curse. You see it? There shall be what? No more curse. But the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be it. And his servants, we, the children of God, shall serve him. Verse 4. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. The Bible said, let no man trouble me. Galatians chapter 6, 17. For I bear upon my body the mark of Jesus Christ. So we have something. We have an inscription on our head. And Christians don't know. We keep moving out of ignorance until we grow up. We cannot. Look at verse 5. Oh, karababa. This is the garden. God is restoring life now. There shall be no night there. They need no lamp, no light of sun. For the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign what? Forever and ever. You shall reign forever and ever. You will never lack any good thing, because you have been restored through the blood of Jesus Christ. There is a mark of his name upon your head. Let no man, let no power, let no authority trouble you. For you bear upon your body the mark of Jesus Christ. You have been redeemed from every curse of the land. Every curse in your family. You just have to discover who you are and begin to walk into your purpose. God has blessed you with all blessings. Forever and ever you shall reign. In the name of Jesus Christ. God, let me show you something before we leave. Psalm 110 verse. Makatara verse 2, Psalm 110. Even David saw it. Oh, we have been restored. And many of us did know. Do we happy in Jesus? Psalm 110. The Bible said, the Lord said to my Lord. By this time, Jesus was not born, but David saw Jesus. Came, died, and went back and sat in the right hand. Said to my Lord, sit on my right hand. Where is Jesus seated? In the heavens. In the right hand of God. Till I make your enemies your footstool. Verse 2. The Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of where? The church. Zion. What did he say in the last thing? He said here. Rule in the midst of thy enemies. Why are we not ruling? Jesus is seated. God said, don't get up. Don't do anything. Sit down. Until I make your enemies your footstool, because I'm going to set your rod out from Zion, the church. And we now have to rule. In the, God did not say the enemies will run away. You rule what? In the midst of thy enemy. What did David say in Psalm 23? The Lord shall prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemy. Your enemies will not die. They will see you great. You some people wish, oh, let them die so that I can live. No, they are not holding you. You are above them. They are under your feet. Luke chapter 10, 19. Behold, I give you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. All the power of the enemy is under my feet. Rule in the midst of thy enemy. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for we know that you have done it. As we live here, Lord, we begin to walk in our purpose. And many of us that have not discovered, help them to discover their purpose. Discover the will of God concerning their life and begin to align their spirit and their body with what God has said. For things begin to happen. Lord, we are not pursuers of miracles. We are miracles and signs and wonders. For Jesus said, Mark chapter 16, 17, he said, for this sign shall follow them that believe. Until we get to that place whereby we are carriers of signs and wonders. We don't chase signs. We don't chase wonders. We have them in us.
Because out of us shall flow the rivers of living water. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, everyone that is hearing the sound of my voice, I speak unto their spirit man to come alive and begin to take possession and take charge of their community, their tribe, their land, their family. Let us begin to dominate, subdue the enemy, and dominate him in everything. Thank you, Lord, for we know that you have done it. In